Today, and talk about excited, new sidewalks and new year coming, we're talking about staying positive. And boy, that's not something we all need to hear today. Amen?
Amen.
So Proverbs 11:27 says this, "Those who look for good find favor, but those who seek evil, it will come to them." You see, we seem to be more drawn to the negative. Ray Williams is a psychologist. He wrote Wired for Success in Psychology Today, and he said this, "The capacity to emphasize the negative rather than the positive has probably been an evolutionary phenomenon. From our earliest beginnings, being aware of and avoiding danger has been a critical survival skill." Or as my friend Dr. Tim McNeil would say, "With every new experience, we wonder, is this going to eat me, or am I going to eat it?" And that's kind of the way we're brought up. And the problem is that nowadays, we don't really have anything. Did anybody get chased by a lion, or a dinosaur, or anything? Oh, a couple people over here. But for the most part, none of us were chased by anything that was going to eat us. We don't really have those fears. But we're wired that way. The wirings remain the same. And it's permeated our world. It seems like we've taken a hold of that as the better way. So negativity is our go-to method of reasoning. I don't have enough money, so I'm not happy, for instance. You know, but I really believe some of the richest people in the world are some of the most unhappy people in the world. Because that's not what it's about. And so we've got to figure out what makes a difference. And what we're going to do is we're going to talk about transformation, because that's what Jesus Christ does to us. Jesus Christ transforms us. And for us, even though we are wired this way, we can believe that God's in control. And because that is what's needed to stay positive, and in particular, this week, to be optimistic. Next week, we're going to talk about being grateful. And the following week, we're going to talk about being enthusiastic. Tony's going to preach the Sunday after Thanksgiving. He's the Sunday after preacher. And so he's going to preach on enthusiasm. And I'm sure he'll be very enthusiastic during that, so be a part of that. But today, we're talking about being optimistic. Oscar Wilde said this once, "We are all in the gutter, but some of us are looking for the stars." Today, we stay positive by first being optimistic. To stay positive is to be optimistic. Let's pray. Lord God, you know in our hearts we all want to hear this. We want to believe this, but the fact is that not only our wiring, but our world is wired to take us down a different path. Help us today, as we felt your amazing spirit in this place, your very presence in the harmonies of our singers and our band. We know you're here. So take this opportunity to teach us to be just a little more optimistic. May your words, may your scripture, may your way be fed through the next few minutes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today, mostly, what we're going to talk about, I tell you to get a Bible out of the pew, but we just took them all out, so you can't do that. You can look it up on your phone if you want to. We're going to be talking about Romans 8. Romans 8 is like a toolbox for optimism. Craig Rochelle, who wrote this original series and made these cool videos, that, boy, let me tell you, that song's going to stick in your head for years. I'm just going to tell you right now, I've been humming it all week, but yeah, he suggests that there's plenty of things in Romans 8 to make it positive. I'm going to share some of the ones I've seen, the ones I see in the midst of this. And so, there, start with, we'll go right to Romans 8:1. "Therefore is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. Tool number one, this is simple. There is no condemnation. That says it all. So we can probably just go ahead and go to lunch now. Ready?
Yeah. Yeah.
But you know we better than that. Because we also know how we are, and we're like, that's just too easy. Jesus is, and when we are in Jesus Christ, there is no condemnation. And so if that's too easy for us, where our negative minds are like, wait, there's got to be a catch about that somewhere along the way. My grandmother taught me differently. My grandmother taught me that anytime I did anything wrong, God was going to crush me. Anybody else have that experience at all? Yes, yes. And so when I went to church, I went in fear. I was afraid not to go, but I was afraid when I was there because Lord knows I make mistakes pretty often on a regular basis. And it was coming. But the scripture tells us different than that. That is not what it was about. It's not just waiting to get squished when we can screw up. The problem is that we have it set in our minds. It matters what we think is most important. For those who, verse 5, for those who live according to the flesh, set their minds on the things of flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the Spirit. So there is this idea that if we follow the world's way, that's going to be a mess. But that's all we know. We seem to think that's the answer. But if we listen to what God is saying, there is no condemnation. We're set. That's pretty something optimistic, isn't it? Yeah, really, you're optimistic. Do I have to do jumping jacks up here or what? That's a pretty cool thing. That's a very cool thing. Right off out of the box. You'll get 39 verses to go here, but we hear from the beginning. There is no condemnation, and that should be the basis of our walk through life, living with that kind of a thought in our head. But those who live according to the Spirit, the thing are the other things of Spirit. And you notice in that passage, it doesn't say there is no condemnation, asterisk, or but, or anything like that. There's no asterisk up there, and you look down the bottom and say, except right here. Here's the good thing. If you don't clap for Tom every once in a while, then you're not going to get into heaven. It doesn't say that, does it? Shameless, isn't it? And the problem is that we read that, and with this negative wiring that we have, what we say is there's no condemnation, but we have the buts, don't we? We have the buts in our lives where we say, but this can't possibly be forgiven. We have the, but I can't possibly get back where Christ wants me to be. That's not true. There is no condemnation. I remember thinking, I believe in Jesus, so I'm going to sin no more. And then when I was a kid, because my grandmother mostly, I would go and sin again. You know, that's what I'm human. And immediately I'm like, oh man, this time I've done it. And I put a but at the end of there is no condemnation. But there is no condemnation, period. For those who are in the Lord, that's what God calls us to be. And that's where we want to be. So that's what we remember. Wesley taught us that by grace, we've been justified. So the day we say, you know what, Lord, I want to follow you, we are justified. Our sins are paid for. Everything has been done on the cross. And we're okay. And then what Wesley teaches us is that we go on in what we call sanctification or growing more like Jesus. But guess what? We're not going to do it perfectly, are we? Oops. We're not even going to walk across the stage perfectly, are we? We're not going to do it perfectly. But there is no condemnation. We've been justified through Jesus Christ on that cross. And that's where what matters. So we grow a little bit every day. We grow a little bit more like Jesus in our walk. And I got to tell you, I'm a little better than I was yesterday and the year before and the decade before. Praise God. But God is walking right with me. There is no condemnation. Secondly, we have to, as the verse 5 says and verse 6 says, to set the mind on the Spirit. That's our second tool. We've got to set our minds on the Spirit. Verse 6 says, to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. P peace surpasses all understanding. There's nothing better than understanding that when we walk with Jesus Christ, when we follow by the Spirit, you know, not just when the music's playing and then heavenly, I mean, it was heavenly in here, amen? This morning when they were singing in harmony, I was like, I'm right close to Jesus. I know it right now. But the truth is we have that opportunity by grace every step of our lives. If we will take it. But what we tend to do is get right back into the world. Or at least like how I put all you in with me, I tend to do. Because I get right back into the world. I start looking at the negative things. But if we set our minds on the Spirit, it's going to be better. Why on earth wouldn't we do that? Because, you know, why on earth wouldn't we set our minds on the Spirit? That's just so simple. And the problem is, it's like that pessimistic nature. We just say, that's too easy. It's just too good to be true. We live in a world that promises false things all the time. You know what I'm talking about? You have already won. Have you ever got that phone call? Yeah. Or in the mail, you get that list of prizes, and there's like these great things down here where you get the top of a coffee tumbler or something. And one of these is yours. You already won. All you have to do is come and whatever, blah, blah, blah. Or you aren't going to believe this, but I get keys to a brand new car all the time. Isn't that cool? I just haven't had time to go pick up my car yet. The world is full of false promises. And it's like we are living on those, and so we keep thinking, well, maybe this will be the one. Maybe this will be the ticket. Yeah, the world has nothing to offer us. And so we have to live into the Spirit and find a way to understand that that's what God has in store for us. We keep looking to the earth answers, and all we have to do is set our mind on the Spirit. The benefit of, a few weeks ago I asked you if I could go ahead and take Sabbath. Man, you guys have done a really nice job of not texting me or emailing me, and you know, the only thing I'm answering on Fridays is my phone. But one of the other things I'm doing is no TV. Michelle didn't even know this. I told her yesterday that during my Sabbath, I don't watch TV. So I have no TV, no news, no CNN, no Fox, no nothing. Just a beautiful presence in the day. I actually put a picture of my bike ride on the rail to trail this weekend because it was heavenly. I just wanted to take all of you and say, look at this. So of course I posted that on Facebook, but don't tell anybody. I didn't go back to see if anybody looked at it, but I posted it on Facebook. But that benefit of unplugging from the world is unplugging 90% of it is negativity, amen? So find a way to unplug from it. That's what your Sunday should be about. Your Sundays should be about unplugging from the world. That's what Sabbath really is. And that's what God's calling us to. And that's how we train to be in the Spirit, to live in the Spirit of God. I feel like I'm preaching now. Oh, wait, that's what I'm supposed to be. 2 Timothy 1:7 says this, "But God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline." And when we're not focusing on Jesus, we're missing all that power. That's an amazing gift. Tool 3, believe that it is going to be better. The first day of first grade, I came home, and there was a newspaper sitting on the couch, and I picked up the newspaper, and I picked it up, and went to read it, and I couldn't breathe. I was mad. They told me when I got to kindergarten, I was going to learn to read. And I didn't do it. And I had to work at it all year long. You know what happened, though, by the end of the year? I could read. So what didn't happen right then? That first day was terrible, because I thought I was going to find out why they kept holding that newspaper up every day. And it didn't work for me, except for the comics. It's always work. But that, it didn't work. And that's the way it is with doing things. You know, we start and it takes work and sometimes it takes pain. How about those folks that are on Weight Watchers? I think the first day you thought, this is going to be great. Was it? No. No, but when you started to succeed at that and you started to feel better, it was like something completely different. It got better. The same is true in everything about our life. When we walk with Jesus Christ, it's going to get better. Verse 18 says this, I consider that the sufferings of the present time are not worth comparing to the glory about to be revealed to us. And if we look back three chapters to one of my favorite chapters, well, Romans is a great book, but chapter 5, suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us. Say that with me. Hope does not disappoint us. That's optimism, right? Because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. Our faith says it's worth it. This glory that's about to be revealed. And it's not something up there, far, far away. This glory happens when we start following Jesus Christ here and now. So, you know, you don't have to put it off. Everyone thinks it's in heaven. God is in this house. Amen? And that's where it starts. And that's where we start to grow. And the next day is going to be better. Tool number 5. The Spirit helps us in our weakness. There are a lot of things that I don't do well. And one of them is to give stuff back to God. Anybody else have that problem? You know, like you're having a miserable day. Absolute thing to do, according to good old Romans 8, is to give it back to God. Because the Spirit helps us in our weakness. And when I get to the point where I'm just wrapped up, I had this happen to me this week. I was so wrapped up. And what I do is I come to this altar right here, and I gotta tell you, I come here more times than I count. And I open my hands and say, God, this is too much. And I can't do it. In other words, I'm too weak to do this. And the Spirit takes that. As long as I let the Spirit have it, I'm in a better place, right? Because the Spirit even helps us in our weakness. We have to take a moment to do that. And of course, we all grab hold of it again. But everything in verse 26, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. No matter what it is, you can give it to God, and God is going to handle that, to lay it at the feet of Jesus. That's a tool, right?
Okay. Yes.
Okay. Next, this is, again, one of my favorite verses, my wife's absolute favorite. Tool number 5, what works for the good? Everything. Everything works for the good. It says in verse 28, we know that all things work together for good for those who love God and who are called according to His purpose. So we talked about this a couple of times, maybe last week, or whatever. Even our screw-ups work for good. God is amazing. Even when we have a bad day, or even when something goes horrendously wrong, at the end of that journey, God is the one who made it go on. Amen? That's what we believe. That's what the Scripture tells us. That's a tool for us. How can you not be optimistic when you know everything's going to work out together for good? Those who love the Lord according to God's purpose. God's purpose is happening even in the most miserable point. Has anybody ever lost a job and then ended up in a better job? Anybody? I bet that first day you were thinking, oh my gosh! It's actually how I ended up here. Everything works together. Next, tool 6. If God is for me, who could be against me? Franklin D. Roosevelt said, the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. And you've heard that famous line, and he said, listen to how it continues. He goes on to say, nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror. In other words, everything that's in the night kind of thing is what he was saying. He said, that's what we fear, those nameless things. where he took us, to the pure of the unknown. But if we know that God is for us, and God that might even be against us, that's the way it works. Verse 31, what then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? If God is for us, who is against us? This is the I think I can verse from Romans 8. You know what I mean? From the little train? Good. I think I can. Repeat with me. God is for me. Ready? God is for me. Then no one is against me. Nothing holds weight to God's love and holding us. And that's when it matters. We can just start thinking God is for me. Because we think God's there situationally when we have our good days, right? Oh, I help somebody. God is for me. You know what? God's still for you when you try to ask that person in need. Amazing. That's the God of love. That even when our conscience is sick up, He loves us beyond compare. That's the God we serve. That's the God that we can be optimistic about and recognize even in our worst days, when we screw up, when we treat somebody miserably, God still loves us. And that's what the last tool is. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. We heard in our scripture today, for our enemies to be your death, your life, our angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And the best part of that is the word of God here. Not even us! Because we are our biggest critics, right? That little negativism in us, things that we can move ourselves away from God. God will not stop loving you. God will love you immeasurably and eternally. That's what we believe. That's God's nature. God is not able to do it any other way because that's the power of who God is. That's a tool. Talk about being optimistic. The God who created you, the God who created everything around you, loves you. Loves you more than you can understand. Loves me. Even when I go on past 12 o'clock, I haven't done it yet. God loves me. That's something to be optimistic about. The battle for our souls is won. It was won on the cross. A long time ago, Jesus died for our sins and rose from the dead and conquered all death. So we know that it's ours. And that battle is won. And that should be our optimism. We're on the winning team. Yay! Do it again. Yay! Okay, we'll move the chairs tonight. Right after the worship service here, so I'd like you to say, I'm letting y'all go.
Yay!
You can say,
yay!
Can we take those names down, please? All right. That's something we've got to remember. Because if we accept Jesus Christ as our truth, and if you haven't done that yet, I want to tell you, there is a much better way. Because I know you're in pain without Jesus Christ in your life. There is this love that will not fail ever. And that's what we look for. Set your eyes on Jesus Christ. Set your sight on that Spirit that's in this room. I know you know it. All of us did, didn't we? And that's where God wants us to be. And if we want to stay constant, pull out Romans 8. I recommend that what you do is you go ahead and photocopy that. And you just put it in your wallet or carry it in your car or something. Because there's going to be something that happens this week, right? You're going to be like, oh no, here it comes. But what's coming is the King. Always remember that. What's coming is the King. Let me close with this. Micah 7:7. But as for me, I will look to the Lord. I will wait for God for my salvation. My God will hear me. That's something to stay positive.